need some water, please don't hesitate to stop by there. Also, as a reminder, we're reminded of the 100 Women Red. The Greater Mount Vernon Zion AME Church is going to be hosting a virtual service on February the 27th, which is Saturday, and it'll be at 10 a.m. via Zoom. And if you need more information to attend that, please contact the office. Also, as you are coming to any of the entrances, you may notice there are some thermometers on each of the entryways. So if you need to use those, please do use that for your protection. And then Pastor Blanco will talk to us about the program planning meeting next Sunday.
Yeah, next Sunday, the 28th, right after church, we're invited here, invited to come over to the fellowship hall. What we want to do is kind of have a town hall. It's just a brainstorm, and everybody bring ideas for the program of the church, the outcome of the church. It's not a formal meeting where we're going to vote or anything, but we'd like to invite you to bring your ideas there. We'll offer lunch as well, so it'll be next Sunday right after church. Thanks.
Okay, are there any other announcements that we can make today? Olinder site, number 258. Can you see it at this time?
Yes. Gracious Father, we come before you as one people with one voice. First of all, to worship you, for you are God, always worthy to be praised. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy, for your kindness upon this congregation and its families. And thank you, Lord, that you have protected us throughout this harsh week. But today, Lord, we want to lift up those people who are hurting. don't know their name. We don't know their face. We don't know their home or their need. But Lord, in the name of Jesus, we lift them up. And Lord, we lift up also all the organizations that are trying to help so many people. There's different ministries and nonprofits. Even these people handing out water today, we want to lift them up as well. In the name of Jesus, let them be your hands reaching out to those who are in need. But Lord, we want to lift up especially Jerry Abel, our brother and friend. Pray that your angels will be there, that your hand will be there, Lord, upon his body. And that this episode, Lord, might be for your honor and glory. And that the faith of Jerry and his family, Lord, might grow and be strengthened. No matter what the outcome may be. But blessed Father, we pray. And we pray, Lord, for Sherry, who had this heart transplant. Lord, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we pray for her. We know there could be issues related to this. But we believe in a God who opened the Red Sea. Believe in a God who walked on the earth and opened the eyes of the blind, and who made the lame to walk. And I'm sure that he can place his hand upon this heart, upon Sherry's body, and make it all seem well. Glorify yourself through all your children here, have faith and who pray in their hearts. Bless them, Lord. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. At this hour, we're going to give Ben Kemp, our Scout representative, time for a presentation. Brother, please come forward.
Good morning. So this is an unusual Scout Sunday for us. Anybody else tired of living through historic times? Okay. So we did not ask the Scouts to come and join us this morning because of various things. But those who are Scouts, we invited, so we have the Ramses in uniform again. And I would be in uniform, but certain challenges this week have delayed laundry day. Which some of you might relate to. But I am wearing my United Methodist Commission Committee on Scouting shirt, which is a good reminder that scouting is a ministry of the church, and that it's a big tent for Boy Scouts, for Girl Scouts, for big brothers and big sisters. And so, on this Sunday, we recognize all of those. But I do want to call your attention to a couple of things specific to Boy Scouts of America today. First off, we are celebrating the 100th anniversary of the partnership of the Boy Scouts of America and the Methodist Church. You may remember that we said the same thing last year. Certain events last year caused the Methodist Church to decide that we would celebrate again this year because we missed out on some stuff. So it's the 100th anniversary, Mark II, however you want to look at that. And I think this week has shown that there are certain things that scouting will teach you that might be of use. Part of the brand is prepared for life. There's a lot of scouts and scout alumni who have used some skills this week that they didn't really plan on, that they might have learned along the way. But I also want to take a moment and recognize one of our own, Some of you are aware that Hunter Hayes received his Eagle Scout last Saturday. In recognition of a long career in scouting and lots of work along the way, and service to this church specifically, because his project was to help landscape the area in front of the office after we lost the tree. And it was tremendously interesting to me how quickly after that, Hunter knew exactly what he wanted to do, because this was his home. And he felt like his home was missing something. Without that tree, he didn't feel as welcoming out front. And so he fixed that. Not because it's going to look better today, but because a generation from now, it's going to look like it did for us. He's got the long view. We also recognized Hunter for another achievement last week, as he received the BSA Medal of Merit, which is for heroic action, possibly life-saving, possibly at risk to yourself. You may remember that he stood up here a couple of years ago and got a word from the Methodist Church that was similar, recognizing the same event, but doubly so because another event he participated in would have earned him the same award. And his actions those 2 days are in part a result of scouting. They're in part a result of his having grown up in this church with all of you around him, teaching him and guiding him so that he could make the right choices when the time came. And that's what our scouting ministries are about. And so as we celebrate 100 years of scouting again, as we recognize the achievements of our youth, as this congregation tangentially sends off 9 Girl Scouts who are graduating, off to college, off to the military, off to whatever the next stage is, you all have influenced those children. Whether it's through your service, whether it's through your donations, whether it's through your smiles, each and every one of us has a part to play. And so this Scout Sunday, I thank you for your support. And I ask that you continue to support our Scouts in whatever way you can. Every day, every week, we reach out and we touch these children's lives. And that's what God has called us all to do. Amen?
Amen.
This morning, our scripture reading comes from the Old Testament in Numbers. Chapter 14, verses 1 through 11. Then all the congregation raised a loud cry, and the people wept that night. And all the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness? Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become booty for Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt?" So they said to one another, "Let us choose a captain and go back to Egypt." Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the Israelites. And Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes and said to all the congregation of the Israelites, "The land that we went through as spies is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land that flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they are no more than bread for us. The protection is removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them." But the whole congregation threatened to stone them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of the meeting to all the Israelites. And the Lord said to Moses, "How long will this people despise me? And how long will they refuse to believe in me, in spite of all the signs that I've done among them?" This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, God.
We'll now have special music, and it'll be Honor, Honor, with this dying man by Tyler.
Amen. Honor and honor unto the dying Lamb. You know, before I start, I've got to, I just want to echo what Ben has said, that, you know, I think that Scouts are a wonderful ministry, a necessary ministry for, not only for the church, for our community, but for society. And I think it's an honor to be able to have that ministry in this church. And so I hope that we can do a better job in supporting them in the several aspects that they need to be helped. But I gotta say, during this week, I remembered Jack and George, because I know they're Scouts. And so, there we are in the fireplace. And so how do you start a fire? And so I was gonna call Jack and George and say, well, what do you need, a charcoal lighter, a Walmart log? See, if I had to start it on my own, that's not going to happen. So I had to cheat, But I'm sure you could do it, right? So, yeah, but I thought about you. Today's sermon I have entitled, The Unbelievable God. The Unbelievable God. The Not Believable God. And in the end, we have an opportunity to believe God. Because the story of the wilderness in the book of Numbers and Exodus is a story of unbelievability in God. Constant rejection of God. Not understanding and not accepting the very things that you see with your eyes are not enough to convince you that God is with you. And so the story of Numbers 13 and 14, we talked about already last week. You have the 12 spies that go into Canaan. They come back and everybody says it's a great place. It's a fertile place. But two of them say, you know, let's go up there and let's take this land. God is with us. All the people that are there won't be able to stand against us because God is with us. But 10 of them, the Bible says, gave an evil report. They said, the land eats up its people. All the men are like giants. Never mind the giants that are there. The walls are so big, they're impenetrable. But you know, in the Old Testament, in the original language, evil report is one word. It's only one word. And it has been translated in different versions, depending on the version that you have before you, as bad, a bad report, discouraging report, unfavorable report. But the King James uses evil report, which I think is closer for this reason. It means a murmuring whisper that glides unnoticed. It glides unnoticed. Kind of makes you think of a snake. It's an evil report. They see the same things. All 12 of them saw the same thing. Two of them say, let's go and take the land because God is with us. But these other 10 give their report as if to cause damage, to bring evil to the people. That's why we started the verse. The first verse, 14:1, says, and the people were weeping. Everybody was breaking down because of the 10. So the immediate result is that the people believe the second group. I don't understand why they believe the second group, but they did. And they start weeping. And after a long night, they confront Moses and Aaron and Caleb and Joshua for saying that they should not be afraid and that they should go up into the land and just take it. And then they started picking up stones to kill them. And just then, the very next verse, the glory of the Lord appears in the tabernacle, and the Lord himself appears, and he saves the four. And then the Lord has these two questions. Number one, how long will this people continue to provoke me? Now it's only been 6 or 8 weeks since they left Egypt. It's not like they've forgotten the plagues. It's not like they've forgotten the Red Sea. But God is asking Moses a rhetorical question. How long will this people continue to provoke me? But the second one is, I think, even stronger. How long will it take before the people believe me? Or believe on me? Because they don't. From our perspective, if somebody were to say something, how long is it going to take for you to believe me? What kind of a sentiment is behind my words? What comes to mind? How long is it going to take for you to do this? What comes to mind? Frustration? Right?
Doubt?
You could say. But it's not that God is frustrated. It's not that God is necessarily perplexed. I don't know what to do with these people. You know, that's not what God is saying. Even though he adds, after all the signs and wonders I have done, they still don't believe me. And that's why he says, you know, it's almost as if you want to say, I just don't understand. You know, as I was writing this, I was thinking about my own life. And many, especially when I was 13, 14, many days, my father would whip me at 13, 14. And I've told you before, you know, the belt, the shoe, the stick, the what do you call this? Huh? What do you say that in English?
Hairbrush.
I mean, like with your hand with your knuckles.
No.
All that. And I remember distinctly one time. Is this Samuel, right? Samuel? When are you going to understand? Why do you want me to punish you? Over and over and over. It's almost as if God is saying that. But not because he doesn't understand. It's the opposite. It's an expression that points to the root of the human problem that we have been dealing with. What is the root of the human problem? What is the root of why these people don't believe me and they continually provoke me, knowing that I am so powerful, I can destroy Israel in a second, like I destroyed the Egyptian army. I can just destroy everybody. But it doesn't register. They're not even afraid of God. And they provoke him. What is this root problem? It's this pesky little inbred sin that is common to all human beings, which is why the Lord Jesus Christ came. It's this inbred resistance to believe in God, to accept God, to accept his ways, to accept his word,
And he wants people to see them. He doesn't hate the people. He understands the people. And he wants them to turn. God is fully aware. You know what I thought about? I was thinking of Lynn. But, because he's from the Bayou. It's as if Israel was, think about this, and if you're familiar with South Texas, you understand what I'm going to say. It's as if Egypt is South Texas. You're in slavery in South Texas, where there's oranges, grapefruits, onions, pepino, melons, watermelons, cattle, fishing. There's everything in South Texas. It's a great place to be a slave. And that is like Goshen, where Egypt, where Israel was enslaved, just like that. And now he's going to say, you know, I have another place for you. I have a place for you to go where I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make you the greatest nation in the world. It's called Sanderson. Anybody went to Sanderson? Did you go by that? When you went to the Big Bend? Pass by Del Rio, right? And you keep going. And you hit a little place called Sanderson, which is, it's a ghost town almost. There's nothing there but rocks and desert.
The smell.
What?
The smell.
The smell. That's exactly what God is doing. He's taking them from South Texas, and he's taking them to Sanderson, where he's going to show them his glory, his power, and who he is. And they don't believe him. Why? Because of what you see. And what do you see? Rocks, desert, tumbleweed, heat, smell. I don't know what that means, though, but that's what they see. And of course, it's this thing within us that all of a sudden we get exasperated, get frustrated. I don't like this. But this is where God wants you to be. So this natural resistance to God turns to a rejection of God. And you read the rest of the story. The Lord ends up plaguing the people of Israel and cutting them off. Not all of them, but enough that brought this evil word. So I want to end with this, brothers and sisters. I'm reading a book called I Saw the Revival in Wales, England, in Britain. I Saw the Revival in Wales. And it talks about the revival in Wales in 1903 to 1904. And do you know that it was started because of a church youth group? A church youth group, teenagers and early 20s, they decided that they wanted to pray for their country, for Wales. And they started to pray and constantly seek the face of God. And God brought down such a tremendous outpouring of his power that the entire world was inundated with the revival. But do you know how they decided to do it? They decided to keep the ordinances of God. Anybody heard that? If you're a Wesleyan or a Methodist, you know what that is. The ordinances of God, and I'll name them. Also called the means of grace. Public worship of God, what we're doing. The preaching of the word, what I'm doing. The supper of the Lord, which is what we do every so often. Family and private prayer. Study of scriptures. And fasting. Except for one thing. They decided to do all these things, but seeking the face of God every time that they did it. Not just coming to church. We're going to go to church and we're going to sing to God because God is with us. Because the Lord is expecting us. I am singing to God. take communion because Jesus himself is offering communion to me. Jesus himself is offering his blood to me in a personal way. I'm going to pray, and every time I pray, I know that the Lord is listening. And every time I study the Word and I read the Word of God in the Bible, I'm going to do it because I'm going to hear the voice of God speaking to me. You see the difference? I'm going to do it because it's a personal thing. And I'm seeking the face of God. And it took him 13 years for this group to pray. But he came. These people believe that God could do a miracle in a small country. Do you believe that God can do a miracle at First United Methodist Church, Elgin? Don't say yes. Because if you say yes, that means you're willing to seek his face and tell him every day, I believe, Lord, that you can do something miraculous right here, right here. Because it starts here, and then it goes out this way. So, I invite you, brothers and sisters, the same God who brought Israel through the desert into the promised land is the same God of this congregation and that congregation, that congregation, and all the congregations around me. It's the same God. Do you believe him? Do you believe you can do it? Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Today, we want to just pass out the ashes in just a minute. But we want to do it as a discipline with some meaning, especially after what we have just said. So abide with me as we go forward. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's Passion and Resurrection. And it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration, there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by repentance and forgiveness and restored to participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the need we all have to renew our faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of our God, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance and prayer and fasting and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word every day. Together, in the name of our Lord, it is our heart's desire to make a new beginning, to acknowledge the faults in our mortal nature, to turn and face our Lord and Redeemer Jesus Christ, as we seek him by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word. Let us pray silently. to understand, brothers and sisters, that the ashes here have no power in themselves. It is not a charm of any sort. It doesn't carry anything with it. It's ashes. They're ashes. Nevertheless, I believe it can be a holy reminder for the next few weeks. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and repentance, so that we remember that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. I'm going to invite the two ushers to come forward and distribute the ashes. I'm going to invite you to come from where you are and just come by and each one of you pick, I think it would be the easiest thing to just come by and pick up a little bag of ashes. Please come. Some to somebody in your household, and we invite the people watching us on Facebook to come by the office and pick up their ashes if they would like to have them in their home. But let us read the Psalm 51 together. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it.
You do not delight in burnt offerings.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you shall not despise. Now may the Almighty and merciful God, who desires not the death of a sinner, but that we turn from wickedness and live, accept your repentance, forgive your sins, and restore you by the Holy Spirit to newness of life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to invite you to take it home and put it somewhere where you can see it every day and be reminded that we have made a covenant together to walk in newness of life. As we prepare for our offering and the final hymn, let us sing together the offertory response.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for all of your blessings.
Amen.